A couple of points I want to make. We went over the bones osteology yesterday, and I pretty much labeled all these parts. There's one thing I didn't mention, I didn't clarify yesterday. I talked about the coronary fossa right here. That's in the front. I don't know if I made that point clear. It's in the front of the anterior aspect of the humerus, because when you do this, when you completely flex the elbow, that the coronary process of the ulna, which is anterior, is what goes in that coronary fossa. On the back side, on the posterior aspect of the humerus, that divot back there for the olecranon is simply the olecranon fossa. So coronary fossa, olecranon fossa. And I think I labeled everything out just there. The ligaments of the elbow are interesting. I'm going to dissect the shoulder and an elbow today. I think that woman who walked by had a shirt on just like this. Did you see that? It had the thing, the shoulder strap. It was the right color. Did you get your thing in Oklahoma City? Okay. Did you know her? You didn't know her?
I didn't see her.
Okay. So the ligaments of the elbow, there are three that you really need to pay attention to. And the thing about the elbow is it's like the ankle. One side is not like the other side in terms of the ligamentous structure. On the medial side of the elbow here, this is the olecranon right there, there is a large triangular ligament here. This is called the medial collateral ligament. It has different parts, but if you just know it as the ulnar collateral or medial collateral ligament, that's what holds the elbow together medially. Laterally, there's a small band here. It's the lateral collateral or radial collateral ligament on the radial side. And that ligament joins what's called the annular ligament of the radial head. It's a ligament that wraps around the head of the radius. And as you'll see in lab, that radial head ligament, it forms a ring that the radial head rotates within, like this. So you got the radial collateral and the medial collateral and the annular ligament of the radial head. Those are the three main supporting ligaments of the elbow. And I'll find them in a cadaver today and you can see them. The vascular supply that we need to go into here is now we've got our brachial artery because it's past the teres major. Well, this is the brachial artery. It descends and is somewhere right around the elbow joint. And some cadavers, you'll see that the division is way up here. And some is past the elbow. But the brachial artery is going to divide into a radial and an ulnar branch. The ulnar branch is on this side here. It gives off right here in the forearm, what's called the common interosseous artery. The common interosseous. The common interosseous divides, and the common interosseous is going to be right there. It's headed laterally. It's going to dive down towards the interosseous membrane where it will split, and one artery will run on the dorsal side, one on the ventral side of the interosseous membrane. So these two arteries really supply the forearm. The anterior interosseous and the posterior interosseous, they really supply the forearm, the muscles of the forearm. Now if I back up to the brachial artery here, just past the teres major, there'll be a deep branch. So the brachial artery is right here, and there'll be a deep branch going down into the muscle masses. That's called the deep brachial or profunda brachii. Profunda brachii. That would be this artery, it's a big artery right there. The profunda brachii sends muscular branches to the muscles of the anterior and posterior compartment of the arm. Now, around the elbow, just like around the knee, there's a tremendous collateral circulation. You got all of these collaterals here, and you've got all these recurrents here. I don't care that you know any of them. Don't spend your time. Just what I want you to know is that there is an extensive vascular supply around the elbow as it is around the knee. And it has to do with blood supply coming from above and then recurring from below on both the radial and ulnar side. Yes, ma'am.
Is that profunda brachii, is that the same thing as that deep artery?
Yes. Some people call it the deep artery of the arm. Some people call it the profunda brachii. I like to say profunda.
It's a fun word.
Is that, anybody here speak Spanish? Anybody speak Spanish? A little bit? The only word in Spanish I know is Papa Nicolau. When you ask a woman, you know, Papa Nicolau, they know that, oh, when was my last pap smear? Because when you say to someone, when was your last pap smear, they don't know the word pap. But if you say pap, and we had a receptionist, she was just a little darling, and I mean, like my daughter, you know, you just, and she would say, Papa Nicolau, and I would take her in the room to translate for me. I would do everything I could to get her to say Papa Nicolau. I mean, it might be like an 80-year-old woman who hadn't had a pap smear in 40 years, doesn't need a pap smear ever in the rest of her life, but I would ask the question, so like, would you please ask her, what was her last pap smear? Just to hear her say Papa Nicolau. What was, I don't even know what was your question?
You answered it.
We're good, all right. Yeah. Anna was her name, Anna. I mean, she was just a, I got a picture of her with the clinic upstairs, and she was just, and she would know, and I told her, I said, the only reason I get them to say that is to hear you say that, you know, so she would try anything she could not to say it, and I would always corner her just to make her say it. If you look at the brachial artery, there are some features about the brachial artery you should really appreciate. One is if you contract your muscle here like that, you got a little bit of a little muscle there right there, your brachial artery can be felt right here on the medial side of the bulge of your biceps, just above your elbow. You should be able to feel the pulse of your brachial artery right there. Understand, if you take a pulse of a child, you don't take it, the carotid pulse, you feel for the pulse right there. A little baby, that's what, the brachial pulse is what you feel. All right, now, lucky for you, this is the biceps brachii, and I'll go into detail in a little bit, but one of its insertions is it forms an aponeurosis and inserts into the deep fascia of the ulnar side of the arm, the muscles on the ulnar side of the arm. So if you contract your biceps against resistance, you can feel it tighten up over here on this side. That's the insertion right there. You can feel the tendon right there. Okay? The good news for you is that cubital vein and the basilic and cephalic vein we were talking about the other day, that's in the sub-Q space. The artery goes up underneath that aponeurosis. So when you are sticking each other with needles in December, it's very easy to hit the vein. And you have to really work to get under that aponeurosis to get to the artery. Now, I will confess that one of the students reached the artery this year, so you know, you don't want to put that needle into the hub. That's what I'm saying. Okay, so that's a good thing. It's not likely you're going to hit the nerves or the artery because they're underneath and are protected by that aponeurosis. All right. One other thing is that when we get down into here, you've got your radial and ulnar artery. you can feel your radial pulse down here, and you can feel your ulnar pulse as well. And I'll go into that in more detail tomorrow. But suffice it to say today, especially in little kids, little infants, or two-year-olds, that sort of thing, when you're checking the pulse, you want to make a conscious statement, and you will write it down, about being able to detect central pulses, like the brachial and femoral, versus peripheral pulses, like the radial and ulnar, versus the pulse and the pulses in your feet. So you get a kid that's dehydrated or in shock from throwing up, not drinking, blood volume. They're in shock. Blood pressure is down. You want to make a statement about central pulses versus peripheral pulses. I may have said this on day one when we were talking about capillary refill. It's the same thing. If you have a delayed if an infant has a delayed capillary refill, you would expect central pulses to be weak and peripheral pulses to be nearly absent. Makes sense, huh? Alrighty. Here's one of the common problems with the elbow. This is olecranon bursitis. Now, this is not in the elbow joint itself. There is a fluid-filled sac that's right sits on the olecranon between the skin and the bone. And right now, you don't feel it. You really can't feel the olecranon, but it's there. You know, you're resting on it right now with your elbow. If it gets inflamed, it'll fill up with fluid, and you'll have this ping pong ball right here on the olecranon. And it really does look like a ping pong ball right there. It's rather mobile. You can tell it's not associated with the joint. Very well circumscribed. What you do with these things is you just poke a needle in them and drain them. They'll usually fill back up within a short while. There's some things you can do to help prevent them from filling up. One of them is to inject a little steroid back into it and put an ACE wrap around there, or some type of wrap around the elbow, put pressure on it. That'll help keep it from filling up. These things are, you know, this is a little overuse inflammation from golfing, hammering, whatever, you know. So olecranon bursitis, you'll run into that quite often. One thing that let me give you a little bit of clinical advice on is if you've got this thing up here that you're going to drain, don't use a 1cc syringe. Get a 20cc syringe at least, if not a 60, because you don't want to have a needle in something and have to keep draining the syringe. That's stupid. I mean, you look stupid. Get a big enough syringe to drain everything out. Okay? This one down here might be infected. It's red. I don't know for sure. But if it's red and hot, then you need to not only drain it, you need to culture what you drain and start them on an appropriate antibiotic. This is a septic elbow joint. You see this little kid? Not a good picture here. You see how red that joint is right there? The bursa, the olecranon bursa, is not swollen. The whole joint's swollen. So this kid is no doubt in the hospital on IV antibiotics. Septic joints are a big problem. We'll go over this when we get to musculoskeletal. But most common cause of a septic joint is from the IV drug abuse, becoming septic from injecting through skin and it getting in your bloodstream, going to your joints. Another very common cause of septic joints, particularly in people, men, who are less than 35 years old, and it's for some reason that 35 years old is there, is gonorrhea. So if you have a male less than 35 with a septic joint, monarticular, one joint, two things you need to be on their differential first on your differential diagnosis is, are you a drug user, IV drug user, and two, gonorrhea. Okay? Oh, don't look away. Don't look away. Is it IV drugs or gonorrhea? Okay. Now, in little kids like this, this is certainly not either one of those. It could be from any other source. So, yes, ma'am.
Is the Ultranon bursitis the same as like tennis elbow?
No. Okay. Tennis elbow is this right here. Tennis elbow is the epicondylitis. So here's the attachment point, the origin for all the extensors in the forearm. If it's on the lateral side, as I mentioned yesterday, it's tennis elbow. If it's on the medial side, it's golfer's elbow. One of the things that is used to treat this is this little band right here. That band wraps around the forearm here. And so the problem with tennis elbow is as you use it, you know, it pulls on the, every time you do this, it pulls on that already irritated section. So what this band, the purpose of this band is to put it on there, and it serves as kind of the attachment point. It takes some of the pressure off of the real origin there. Understand? And they work pretty well. Anybody here have tennis elbow? Have had it? Everybody? You bet it? One thing, though, I need to, in relation to this picture there, that guy looks like the kind of guy in high school that got his ass whipped every day. So you were definitely not on the football team, you were on the tennis team, you definitely got a butt kicked every day. Okay? You can also inject in the origin of the tendon with steroids, which is kind of a more, a little bit more of a radical treatment. If it's not getting better with non-steroidal anti-inflammatories like Mupirocin, rest, heat, ice, and don't use it. You gotta not use it for a while, let it heal, then you can inject it with steroids. The problem with the steroids, though, is they tend to weaken the attachment here, and you can wind up with a tendon rupture from repeated steroid use. Yes, ma'am?
Is there any truth to those, like the copper-filled socks and
and all that? It depends on who you ask. If you ask me, no. If you ask the people selling them, yes. So, yeah, the baseball players are fanatics about this. You know, if you just watch professional baseball, they always wear these chokers. I guess that's what you call them. They're thick band of braided. You know, they've got copper and plutonium and whatever else, and it's supposed to give them superhuman powers and prevent injury and all that kind of stuff. Well, somebody's making a ton of money off of that. It's like Pet Rocks. You remember Pet Rocks? Somebody made $1 billion selling a damn rock. It's like this thing right here. This thing actually is useful. It works. Pet Rocks don't work. Those chokers don't work. The copper underwear and all that stuff. Anything else? Anybody own stock in the copper underwear company? You're going to turn me into the president now? Did I ask you a question here? Okay. Let's go back a little bit. Here's a common problem you'll see. It's called nursemaid's elbow. And what this is we're at the park and it's like, come on! And you jerk them like this. The nursemaid or the housekeeper or whatever, the nanny. And when they do this in the kid, they pull the radial head out of the annular ligament. Okay? It's a true subluxation of the radial head out of the annular ligament. Now, they're pretty easy. You don't rip the annular ligament. And they're pretty easy to get back in. Bottom line is what you do is you just hold the kid and they'll always have their hand like this. They come in like this. What you do is you stabilize their elbow and then you supinate their arm like that They're gonna resist you, but you supinate the arm and it pushes the, that motion pushes the radial head back into the annular ligament. Okay? They're pretty easy to get back in.
Do you have to use sedation for that?
Do you have to sedate them? No, you usually don't.
Just do it.
Just do it. They're not going to want you to do it, but you can see this little kid right here. You just set them down and just supinate the forearm, and it typically just it screws back in. So you might have to do it several times, but it usually screws back in just fine. These things are really common. You're going to run into this a lot. Okay, so here's a thing called a fat pad sign. Now, you know, I was talking about the coronoid fossa and the olecranon fossa. Those depressions in the humerus, they're full of fat. So when you have a fracture of the humerus, the distal humerus, or somewhere in the elbow, the swelling pushes that fat out. It pushes it off the bone. And when it pushes it off the bone, it changes the density on an x-ray. Because now you're shooting through fat instead of through muscle. That's called the fat pad sign. And I don't know if you can see it on this thing very well. But this is a normal elbow over here. You see the density here is pretty even. There's nothing, it's all the same consistency. Over here we've got a fat pad sign. You see that dark spot right there? And that dark spot right there, it's pretty subtle. That's a fat pad sign. That means that there is a fracture somewhere in there. Now on this one, you don't see the fracture. And on this one, the fracture of the olecranon is apparent. And you see the fat pad sign right there. And maybe a little bit right there, but certainly right there. You see that darkness? Okay, so that's telling you that there's somewhere there's a fracture in that elbow. If you shot it from the other direction, which you would do, you'll probably find the fracture. But on this view, it's not apparent. Okay, any questions about that?
Where
did
you say the fat is normally?
So here's the fat right here. Here's the olecranon fossa right there. The fat is in there inside the capsule of the joint. And when it swells, when the bone swells, it pushes that fat out, and that's where, when it pushes it out, that's when you can see it. That guy. Okay, muscles. The anterior compartment of the arm. So the anterior, we're going to talk about the anterior compartment today and the posterior compartment. Very easy. Tomorrow we'll talk about the anterior compartment and the posterior compartment here. Very easy. There are three muscles in the anterior compartment here. They're all innervated by the musculocutaneous nerve. The first one here is the biceps brachii. It has two heads, a short head and a long head. I mentioned yesterday the short head arises from the coracoid process. The long head goes through the intertubercular groove and arises from the supraglenoid tubercle. The tendon down here, here's the part where it attaches to the aponeurosis on the ulnar side. The other part of the tendon, because it splits, the other part of the tendon attaches on the radial tuberosity. You'll see it on the in the dry bone specimen, the radial tuberosity. The thing about the biceps is that over here, note that it does not attach to the humerus. So there you go. That's kind of an interesting thing. When you do, you know, when everybody's doing this right here, showing the big muscle right here, that's usually not the biceps. That's usually the muscle that's underneath it called the brachialis, which does arise from the middle portion of the humerus and inserts down onto the forearm. I'll get into the actions in just a minute. And the last muscle is the coracobrachialis that arises from the coracoid process and inserts into the humerus. So the coracobrachialis has an action on the shoulder, the brachialis has an action on the elbow. One of the big things on this test, or on all these tests, is how many joints, if I'm asking you about a muscle function, how many muscles have an action on one joint versus two joints? So the biceps has an action on two joints, the shoulder and the elbow, because it crosses both. The brachialis and the coracobrachialis only have an action on one joint. On the posterior compartment of the arm, and we want to look at these today. We want to look at the supraspinatus, the infraspinatus, the teres muscles, the deltoid, and then you want to look at the triceps. The triceps has three heads. The long head of the tricep is, so the cadaver is going to be face down. You have to flip the cadaver over with it. So the cadaver is face down. The medialmost head of the triceps is the long head. It arises from the infraglenoid tubercle. Then you got the lateral head that arises from the humerus. In between the two is the medial head that arises from the mid portion of the humerus. Those three come together as a single tendon and insert into the olecranon. And they're going to have an action. The long head has an action on two joints. The lateral head and the medial head only have an action on one joint. Right? These are the primary function here is extension of the elbow. Now, the keep in mind that the muscles here around the shoulder joint, like the long head of the biceps, the coracobrachialis, the long head of the triceps, because they're around the shoulder joint, they help support the shoulder joint, okay, as one of their actions or functions. Now there's a muscle, there are two muscles in the body that are just stupid. One of them is this one right here, the other one's down in the lower extremity. Anconius arises from the ulna here and wraps around and inserts on the humerus. It arises from the ulna. It's a little flat muscle. It's triangular in shape. Its function is to stabilize the elbow and to assist in, if you have the elbow locked, assist in unlocking the elbow, for example. Assist the triceps. We'll say assist the triceps. I call BS on both. The muscle is too small and too stupid to do anything. But, and some of the cadavers won't have them. Most of them will, though. And you'll see it as this little triangle slip. You say, what's that? That's the anconius. The triceps and the anconius are both innervated by, what's the nerve of the posterior compartment? The radial. They're both innervated by the radial. Branches of the radial. Okay? Any questions about that? Here's the thing that I mentioned yesterday in class. You want to make sure you see this today. We've got the suprascapular nerve and artery right here. And this quadrangle here, it's called the quadrangular space, that's where you're going to find the posterior humeral circumflex and the axillary nerve, right there, coming through there. And right below that, if you move the long and lateral heads of the tricep apart, and I did that on one of the bodies yesterday, you'll find the radial nerve. Was that your body?
Yeah.
You'll find the radial nerve and the profunda brachial or deep brachial artery. Remember, if a fracture of the mid shaft of the humerus, the radial nerve is in jeopardy. Dislocation of the inferior dislocation of the shoulder, the axillary nerve is in jeopardy. Here's a table that describes the actions of these things. you know, read over these actions here. The innervation is really easy. Note that the anterior compartment, most of the function of the anterior compartment is going to be on flexion at the elbow. And because the biceps comes over here and inserts on the ulna, it actually aids in supination. The corpus brachialis is up here, and so it's going to flex the shoulder. Brachialis is flexing the elbow. Triceps, it does essentially one thing. And this is the other few things. And as we get into the forearm, where there are a lot more muscles, I'll give you a similar table that summarizes the innervations and actions of those structures. A couple of clinical things here. Rupture of the biceps tendon usually is off of the coracoid process. And when it happens, it's obviously painful. And the head of the short head of the biceps is going to knot up and contract up, and is going to appear as a bump in the anterior aspect of the arm. This is something I've mentioned before in lab to some of you anyway. When you start an IV in your hand here, an IV can only be left in place, it depends on the policy of the hospital, but usually no more than a few days, 3 or 4 days, before it has to be changed. You can't leave an IV in place forever. But if you need, and these veins down here are small, and they don't tolerate great loads, if you need a bigger vein that can tolerate a greater load, where the catheter can stay in for a prolonged period of time, there's a thing called a PICC line, P-I-C-C, and that's what PICC stands for. And what they've done here is they've taken that catheter and they put it in the basilic vein, which turns into the brachial and in the axillary and subclavian. So they've accessed the venous circulation through this large vein here. You suture it in place, you can suture it in place. These things can stay in place for a long time, weeks. And you can, like for chemotherapy, large boluses of fluid can go through there. Now, these PICC lines have a little stripe in them that's radio opaque. When I say radio opaque, that means it shows up on an x-ray. Radiolucent means it won't. Cartilage is radiolucent. Bone is radio opaque. Anyway, this little stripe is radio opaque, and you can see the stripe going across the chest here. See that tiny little stripe right there? That's the stripe of the PICC line showing that it's in the right place. Oh, I think we saw it one time on an ET tube. Mm-hmm. Can I show this? Yeah, okay. This is hidradenitis. This is the surgery. I mentioned the surgery several times. This is what it looks like. But this guy, he's all nice and clean now. Mm-hmm. Right? So that's what it takes to clean that mess out. This is an interesting thing I get asked about all the time, and some of you probably haven't. It's called familial keratosis pilaris, and it occurs right here. You have it?
Not that bad.
Well, it occurs right here. People think, what is this roughness on the back side of my arm here? This is like, what is going on? The more lotion, the more... moisturizer I put on here, it never seems to fix it. Well, this is an inherited disorder. You can thank your parents for this. And it's just the hair follicles stick out, and it feels rough, sandpapery on the back of the upper arm like this. So you don't do anything with it. You just live with it. You have it? Yeah. Is it like cool like that?
Or no,
it...
not that cool, but
yeah.
It's kind of cool.
So you guys, you know, go up, feel her arm, and grab it. Yeah, if anybody's got any weirdness going on, you ought to let the rest of the class feel it. any questions? Yeah, ma'am.
Some people with gluten intolerance say that they have that, and it goes away once they start. Like, is that a symptom of gluten?
Say it again.
some people will have like a gluten intolerance and they develop something like that. What is that called?
Familial keratosis, gluten pilaris. I don't know. I could ask my sister. She had she wound up gluten intolerant and she stopped coming out of her diet. She feels great. So I'm not sure she has that, but I've never heard it being related to that. Anything else? Okay, let's go to that.